Right, we're at a minute past 12, so I'm going to just kick off. So first of all, afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the second of our practical governance scheme sessions webinars. Today's session is on making the single code, or perhaps I should say the general code, work for you. I'm delighted to be joined today by our speakers. First of all, my colleague Maddy Frost, who is currently a legal director in the pensions team here. But as from Monday of next week, Maddy will be a partner in the team. Congratulations, Maddy. I'm also joined by Amanda Osborne, who is a trustee director at IGG, formerly Ross Trustees, and Rosanne Corbett, who is a client director at Muse Advisory. Just by way of background on our guest speakers, so Amanda has over 40 years experience in the pensions industry. She's worked both in-house and at a number of third-party administrators. She's an experienced operational manager and has a wealth of knowledge and experience in pensions administration. She's worked at IGG for 3.5 years and currently works on a portfolio of clients for whom IGG are sole trustee. She also chairs a number of trustee boards and sits on a number of risk and admin committees. Rosanne leads Muse's governance and risk management services and is on the Muse management team. She advises on risk management, on governance and strategy. And a particular strength of hers is the hands-on experience she brings because as well as doing all of that, she works as an outsourced pensions manager for part of her time. And at the moment, she's spending a lot of time working through general code gap analyses and undertaking the own risk assessment, both in for schemes where she works as a consultant, where she's advising trustees, and also in her pensions manager role. Rosanne is also the appointed risk management function holder for one of the largest Irish DC schemes. And they're a little bit ahead of us in Ireland. So the own risk assessment for that scheme needs to be completed by this time next year. So Rosanne's got a wealth of experience in this stuff and looking forward to hearing from both her and Amanda with their practical experience. I've got a couple of points of housekeeping before we kick off properly. So the session is due to run 12 till 1pm. We're going to aim for about 45 minutes of content to give plenty of time for questions at the end. Your mics and speakers are going to be switched off throughout, although you will be able to see and hear the speakers. If you do have any questions as we go through, if you could please type them into the Q&A function, which you'll see at the bottom of your screen. Only the speakers will be able to see your questions, and we will pick up as many of those as we can at the end of the session. We will be recording the session and we will place it on our website. So we'll send everybody who has signed up to attend the session a link to the recording once we've finished. So Maddy's going to start by giving us a brief overview, and then we're going to move into more of a Q&A format to bring out some of the key themes and to get Amanda's and Rosanne's real life war stories, or perhaps I should say case studies. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Maddy.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much for joining us today. I think the first thing to say is that in terms of agenda, I will only be speaking for a very short time today to set the scene for the discussion. Now, the single code, of course, now the general code has been around for quite a while, first being published in March 2021. So I expect most of you will be pretty familiar with its content. Therefore, the majority of today's session, I will be passing over to Rosanne and to Amanda, who are both immersed in work helping trustees to comply with the code in a practical and proportionate manner. So the focus of today's session will really be to get their input on what practically trustees can do to ensure compliance with the code, particularly as it may seem like quite a daunting task for some trustees, at a time when there are clearly other priorities, a finite amount of resource in terms of both time and money. And also, given the activity in the insurance market, I'm sure a number of trustees are wondering how they ensure compliance in a proportionate way when buyout is on the horizon. So on slide three, just a few headline points from me first. The first thing I want to say is about timing. Now, although delayed, we are now informed that the code will be final by summer 2023. This delay does not mean that the requirements of the code will go away. A lot of the detail in the code, particularly around the ESOG and the ORA, which we'll be talking about today, is taken directly from IORP 2 and has been introduced into UK legislation by amendments to the Pensions Act. So it's clear that despite the delay, the code is here to stay. And coupled with that is the general expectation and indication from TPR that we're not expecting huge differences in the final version of the code to the draft that we already have, although some guidance around proportionality would be welcome. So, quick note on what's new and what's not. First of all, what's not new? I think it can be helpful to bear in mind that the code was intended to help trustees with scheme governance rather than just being an additional regulatory burden on trustees. Of course, there are new requirements, which we will talk about today, but a lot of the requirements, particularly in terms of the required policies and procedures, trustees will likely already have most of them in place. Because of course the code was produced to bring together 10 of the existing current codes of practice and in a way that is actually clearer and more accessible for trustees. And it's probably also helpful to remember that in fact many elements of the existing codes are out of date, not particularly easy to navigate, and how they interact with each other is not always clear. And in addition, hopefully again we can bring this out in the discussion today, the code is designed to help trustees in achieving their objectives and assisting with the scheme's journey plan, and ensuring an effective system of governance should benefit trustees, ensuring that they adequately manage risk to protect scheme benefits and pay benefits as they fall due, which is of course the ultimate goal for all involved in a pension scheme. But of course there are a few new things. It's not just a consolidation of existing codes, and we have a few new acronyms to add to the many in the pensions industry already. The first is the ESOG, or the Effective System of Governance. This is the legal requirement under the Pensions Act for trustees to establish and operate an effective system of governance. And the code sets out what TPR expects trustees to have in terms of their effective system of governance. And that's that the trustees should have oversight of the day-to-day operation of the scheme and ensure that it's accountable for delegated activities, which I think is a really important part and something that trustees would be good to revisit to make sure that their delegations are properly recorded. And so the trustee can get assurances that the scheme is operating as it should. Now, this concept of a system of governance, it is quite wide, and it can include anything that could reasonably be considered as part of the operation of a pension scheme. So it's really about the trustee having appropriate policies and procedures in place. Now, the draft code has quite a long list of specific items that TPR expects to see forming part of that ESOG, and I'm not going to run through that list, but just to say there's increased focus on certain things such as contingency planning, probably not surprising following the COVID pandemic, also cybersecurity, climate change risk, and of course a new requirement for a remuneration policy. And the second acronym I want to mention was our ORA, the Own Risk Assessment. And this is a new requirement for trustees to have a written document setting out how well the trustees' system of governance is working and the way in which risks are managed. So this is for trustees to demonstrate that they have fully considered the various risk management processes and how well their policies and procedures address these. The ORA should be in writing, signed by the chair of trustees, and our current expectation is that it should be produced within 1 year of the code being effective and then must be regularly reviewed. Schemes are not required to publish the ORA or to send to TPR, although TPR can request it. But as the regulator is not reviewing the ORA and there's no template or prescribed format, this has led to some concern about, well, what on earth should the ORA look like, and how does this differ from the risk register? And this is something that we will pick up in today's session. So just finally from me, TPR has been at pains to say that it will remain a pragmatic regulator. Now, although TPR warns that it expects the first ORA to be a significant piece of work, it also recognises that it should be proportionate. Now, this concept of proportionality is peppered throughout the code, and it's left to trustees to decide what is proportionate in the context of their scheme. And the code also actually contains a statement acknowledging that some schemes may meet the expectations in a different way to as it is set out in the code. Now, the code itself does not give examples of where or how differences can be accommodated, but this does suggest there is some scope for deviation from the code when it is done in a considered way. So against that background, I'm going to pass back to Liz, who is going to kick off our discussion of the practical aspects. Thanks, Liz.
Thanks very much, Maddy. So, yeah, I mean, I suppose I'd like to probably bring in Amanda first of all. Amanda, I've got a number of trustee boards that I advise who either haven't started the process at all yet or who are right at the beginning of the process. So as an experienced professional trustee, you've got a blank piece of paper in front of you. How do you approach the exercise? What's the first thing that you should be doing?
I think Maddy covered a number of those issues. None of us have got a blank piece of paper. We've already got a number of robust governance frameworks in place. So for us as trustees, one of the first things we looked at is obviously one, understanding exactly what was in the ESOG in particular, what those models was included and what policies were required. So it was us looking at kind of going, what have we got? What have we got in place already? What can we almost just say, yes, we've got a tick box or what we can review? And what are the requirements for the other things that we need to put in place? So it wasn't quite a blank piece of paper, but it was very much adding to what we've already got with regards to that framework we've got. And we all believe that actually the information that was included within the ESOG in particular was actually really good governance. It is things that we needed, and it's things that it required us to look at those policies and procedures we've had in place for a number of years, which are probably out of date. We probably don't look at them enough. And I think it's actually got us thinking of how we can use them, you know, much more in a relevant state and what we do on a day-to-day or year-to-year basis.
Thanks, Amanda. I'll take myself off mute before I start talking. So effectively, you would go through what you've got in place already and carry out a gap analysis, I suppose. Yes. You would call it, isn't it?
Very much so.
Okay. So, Rosanne, just bringing you in here, sort of on a practical level, once you've identified those gaps and you've done your gap analysis, what do you do to make sure you're prioritising the key areas? How do you tackle that, and how do you make sure that the sort of finite resources that you've got are sort of focused in the right place, I suppose?
It's a really good question, and I think it comes back to that point of proportionality that's been mentioned previously. I know we'll talk a little bit about what proportionality means in practice, but looking at it through the lens of, you know, how much of this do we actually feasibly need to do for our scheme based on where it is at this moment in time and where we want it to get to, is kind of the lens I think it's helpful to look through. And that's partly driven by objectives, and I do think linking this work to the objectives is really important, as it's a helpful framework. So if your only objective is to be compliant because you're a very small scheme and you don't have the money to spend on the nice to haves, then your bar of proportionality is going to be relatively low. So actually just doing what you need to do and getting the minimum in place to know that you are compliant and doing the right thing by your members will be a satisfactory target. However, if you are a trustee that has more reaching objectives, then you might look at it through a lens of, can we do things better? Can we make quicker progress? are we being as efficient as we can be? And so the level of proportionality you might apply when looking at the gaps that you have could be quite different. So there is a spectrum in terms of how any of the gaps are approached. I think it's a sensible way in terms of what Amanda was saying, tackling it through looking at your documents and the processes that are in place, as well as then looking at the specific requirements for a system of governance. And they will identify potentially quite a few different gaps. Some of the things that I'm seeing is around, particularly in documentation, but how that links in practice to governance and ways of working. So, for example, discretionary benefit policies are often an example where things aren't quite done in practice as they're documented, or it might not be documented. So I've got a couple of cases where we've got a policy which is documented, however, the administration practice isn't quite following what's in the policy around a standard death benefit. So the trustees aren't actually being referred certain member cases when they should be. And then there's another case where a policy is there, but it doesn't actually reflect the trustee and rules in terms of payment of spouse's benefits when a member's died in retirement. And as a result of that, the processes have fallen down and the benefits have been miscalculated over a very long period of time. So this exercise has been really helpful in identifying, yes, areas for tweaking and improvement, but also some potential skeletons in the closet. So actually being able to look at this from that level of, you know, how much of this do we need to do to help us work better, more efficiently, and do the right thing by members, helps prioritise the actions you take once you've identified those gaps. And of course, the red, amber, green, or red, amber, green, blue sort of matrix might be helpful, because you can identify the things that you just don't have in place that you need to, which might be red, the things that you have but could be tweaked around the edges, or actually need to have new things added into them and therefore expanded, which might be amber, and green you have in place. And there may well be blue things that you don't have, but you feel you don't need to because it's not proportionate to your scheme and the level of complexity. And therefore that gives you a really good starting point to think about what do you do next and how do you then tackle that, because of course everybody's very busy. And so it's fitting around an already busy workload. So planning that over a period of time to do these things that fit in, but also think, where can they be tackled as work that's already being done in progress, or projects that you can see coming down the line? Doesn't all need to be done at once. Remember, the own risk assessment, as you said, is an assessment of the governance that you have in place, as well as the management of risks. But TPR isn't expecting you to be green in everything at that point of assessment. It's expecting things to be done and improved over time.
I think that's really helpful, Rosanne. It's helpful to frame it in that way, isn't it? Because I know sort of a lot of trustees and you know, others involved in the industry see a lot of what TPR puts out and as almost, oh gosh, you know, another tick box exercise that we've got to comply with. And I think probably people would feel better about the time and effort they have to spend on compliance with all of this stuff if they could see, well, it's not just a tick box exercise, there is actually some benefit coming from this. So I think it is helpful that you've been able to see some benefit in the schemes that you've been working with to actually improve the governance and, like you say, highlight some areas that perhaps have not been running so well in the past. I suppose you've got to be careful how far you go, haven't you? Because people don't always thank you for identifying issues.
Yeah, and I think that, well, they don't, because sometimes there's a cost attached to dealing with them. But I think for those schemes that are on a trajectory potentially towards buyouts, finding out about this sort of thing now is actually so much more helpful, because you can tackle it at a time that you're not under pressure to be making decisions at pace.
Yeah, completely agree. I mean, I wonder, either sort of Amanda or Rosanne, whether you've got any views on how the approach might differ for schemes that are on a slightly different journey plan, because you might have a scheme that is, you know, running on and it's sort of quite a long way from the end of its journey. It might still have active members in it, versus a scheme that is on a trajectory towards buyout in the next 18 months, 2 years. Would you take a different approach if you had a scheme that was closer to the end of the line?
I think, if I can answer, I've got a number of schemes that are either sort of, you know, going to buy in this year, or in the process of getting all their paperwork and their data and everything ready to do it next year. And we have looked at those very differently. But the things we pulled out on things like that is around sort of like almost looking at, is part of that project plan as well, around your member communications, having a plan for that. So there's a number of aspects within the ESOG and the AURA that will pull out some of the things you're going to be doing as part of that work as well, which are those, you know, so it's looking at the elements that you kind of need to have in place anyway. It's always good to have great governance. You need to have, you know, a number of those elements in place full stop, whether it's going into wind up, whether your scheme's staying on or anything else. So it's recognising those bits that you just kind of need to do right up the very end, and those bits that actually can fall away. And it's kind of, it is that proportionality. Whereas a scheme that's ongoing, it is very much looking at the bits that you really do need to do. I'm in a slightly different place for a lot of trustees as well. I have a number of schemes which are RUS trustees, sole trusteeship, where we do all of the governance. So for us, that was a very easy approach to take, because we looked at everything and we looked at the size of the scheme and what they're doing and where they are within their journey plan, and we could look at those quite easy with regards to what we felt was required. So we did very much did do that, you know, the red, green, amber approach. You know, we looked at our policies, we made sure they were all okay, we made sure they were compliant and that they were up to date as well. So we've been doing that sort of for the last 2 years. Very different to where I'm a chair of a trustee board. You know, you've got to bring your lay trustees on that journey with you. As trustees, we have so much training and we get to understand, and we, you know, we can literally, you know, lift the bonnet and understand what's happening and what those requirements are. As a lay trustee, you just get that training. So I think the approach for me as a chair was slightly different for the approach that I take for a sole trusteeship. You know, it's much more of a training, of an understanding, of bringing them along, you know, making those phases and phasing those things in, and almost where we decided that we didn't want to do a thing, or we didn't need to do it because of the size of the scheme. We understood that, and actually we all understood it, and we made that decision as a group, as a board.
Yes, I think if I may just add to that, some of the trustees and the schemes where they are on a path to buy out and they're at different stages of it, this process is either, if they're doing it at the moment in terms of thinking about the ESOG and the AURA, is proving helpful from different perspectives. And of course, we've been challenging, do we even need to do any of this if we're a couple of years off buyout? What's the merit in doing it? That's a very fair question. I think for those schemes that are on a longer path, this is actually quite a helpful means of kind of really taking a step back and reflecting on what is it we're trying to do? What are our, you know, what is that end game target? We have a target in terms of a funding amount, but we also have a time frame. And we've also got to think about the sponsor's involvement potentially in this. And it's a helpful means of just putting that plan together and thinking about, what are we trying to achieve? How are we going to do it? How are we going to be resourced? And that resourcing is not just all the providers in place to do the work, because of course there's going to be peaks and troughs in terms of capacity, but it's the advisory support. It's the trustees you have around the table and the composition, as well as any in-house resource you might be lucky enough to have. And what that looks like as you make progress, because it will evolve and the risks attached will evolve. They will become very different. The risks that you have now might either fall away or change shape as you make progress year on year. And so being able to understand that now, early on, is really helpful, because it means you put in place the right milestones for your decisions and activities, but also helps you have a really sensible conversation around what this looks like from a budget perspective as well. Those nearer to buyouts or potentially buy-ins do find this quite helpful, thinking about risk more specifically. And it's not just the big risks of what do we do in terms of IRM, so the funding, the investment, the covenant elements, which are obviously critical as a part of it, but it's the more specific. One of the things that are really going to bite us that we don't know about at the moment, and it may be things like trap surplus. What's written in the rules about use of trap surplus, distribution of surplus? Those are the types of things that can really derail things. Or it might be that you've got a particular member case and it might be one member and they've brought something up and you realise that actually something has been done wrong for a whole category of members, and it means you can't hit buyout at the time you want. And so it's things like that, it's understanding how that looks and where you might need additional support from the sponsor. You might be fully funded at the moment, but as you get closer to buyout, there may be pinch points where you need to rectify things and you need additional support from the sponsor. And of course, any residual risks, how you deal with all of those in that period up to buyout, but also from buyout to wind up. And so there's a lot of things which are more in the detail of risk, which actually are very helpful to think through early on.
It's really interesting, isn't it, Rosanne? Because I think some of these risks people had not focused on at all over the last few years. And you're quite right. Some of the issues that we're coming across now are around trapped surplus, which nobody's ever focused on. We're seeing other things that people have never focused on before as well. So rules around discretionary increases, nobody's ever focused on those before. And we're looking at rules and suddenly realising that actually people perhaps should have been looking at this once a year for the last goodness knows how many years, but it's only just come up because of the current inflationary environment. And of course, the other thing that's coming up at the moment is illiquid assets. So schemes that are very, very close and want to buy in or buy out or transact in some way for residual risks suddenly can't, because they've realised that they're not going to be able to change their asset mix quickly enough in order to be able to take advantage of you know, current moves in the market at the moment. So I think that's a really good illustration, actually, of the point that you made about these risks. They do evolve over time, and you've got to keep an eye on them, haven't you?
Yeah.
I'm sort of wanting to move on to talk about the own risk assessment in a little bit more detail. I'm sort of conscious that a lot of trustees have risk registers in place at the moment, and they spend a lot of time going through risk registers. They spent a lot of time putting them in place in the first place, and they do spend time reviewing them at the moment. This sort of new guidance from pensions regulator talks about own risk assessment. I think it might be helpful if we kind of could first of all just talk about how the two are different from each other. So a trustee is going to have to start right again from the beginning. Are they going to have to scrap the risk register and do something else to start with?
Oh, I hope not. My goodness. No, I don't think that's the case at all. I think, and TPR can correct me on this, I do think the own risk assessment is an iteration, it's a follow-on from the work that schemes will be doing, if they're not already, or will soon be doing, in terms of looking at the documents that they have in place to support effective governance and scheme operations, and looking at the specific requirements of an effective system of governance. Because remember, the ORA is an assessment of that governance and how effective it is, as well as how well the risks are being managed within that framework. And so the ORA for me isn't about rehashing the risk register, it's using the risk register as a helpful means to really think, what are the key risks to us as a set of trustees? For me, I think about risk in the context of objectives. A risk is something that can prevent or hinder the achievement of objective, or conversely, it can expedite the achievement. So you can think about it from an opportunity perspective. And so you may already have a lot on the risk register that is really helpful, but you may well have a very long risk register and you can't feasibly look at 89 to 100 risks in a meaningful way on a regular basis. So the ORA for me is about your key risks. It's those things that are really going to either knock you off course where you're trying to get to, or move the dial to help you make progress. And so I think, and hearing Nick Gannon speak on one of the recent webinars about the code, is that the expectations for the ORA again are about being proportionate. It may be that a very short, focused, high-level document is going to help you. And I think that's the way I I'm going in terms of the work I'm doing with my Irish client. It's very much a strategic document that will help them think about what they have to do in the year or two ahead, what's coming up. It's a forward-looking document. Yes, it reflects a little bit on what's happened to get them to that point, what their objectives are, how they're going to undertake the activities they need to, i.e. project work as well as BAU, what are the key decisions and milestones they have over the year, what's going to help them do that work, as well as what are the risks they need to manage now, but also looking over the horizon to what might be coming down the line that they need to think about. So using it as that sort of tool is actually so much more helpful and value add than it just being a tick box exercise. And in terms of, you know, where we might get information or tools from a best practice perspective, because it's quite hard to create all of these things from scratch, those schemes that have sponsors that produce authors, so own risk and solvency assessments, you might find if the sponsor is prepared to share that document with the trustee, that could be a very helpful tool for you to think about how you structure your aura, what you want to think about in terms of what's in there. Typically, those authors are very strategic tools that are used as part of the end of year reporting and business planning process for a business. And it looks at lots of different things. But the key bits in there are strategy, objectives, risk, risk appetite, activities for the year ahead. And so a similar approach for the aura could actually be very useful. You can make it as long or as short as you like, I think. You can go to town on it. But the other aspects of the own risk assessment is the operational side. For anybody who's looked at the code or the governance regulations that are already in place, it's clear that there is a lot which sits within the operational elements of schemes. So the admin of benefits, for example, financial transactions, payment of benefits, movement of money. So from trustee bank accounts to members or between trustee bank accounts, if you have more than one, or from custodians to trustee bank accounts, all of that needs to be really looked at in detail. And this is where it's taking risk management a little bit of a step forward. So risk management isn't just about looking at the risks in the risk register and checking what colour they are. If your controls aren't operating as defined and effective, your risks won't be well managed. And unless you know what those controls are and test them for their effectiveness, you won't know if the information you're getting in your management reports and your stewardship reports are answering the questions you have, giving you the right assurance and comfort that your controls are working for you and therefore that your risks are being managed. So there is a little bit more, I think, coming from the code, which is where the assurance reporting comes from, and the talk around internal audit had the intent, I think, to get trustees to think more about how they actually look at and scrutinise the controls. So it's not to get into the detail, but it's to make sure that the reporting and information you receive from those who run the scheme on your behalf is helping you understand that things are being done as they should be, and that supports your decision making at a strategic level. It shouldn't get in the way of it. It should support and help it.
What would you actually do in practice to get under the bonnet then? Rosanne, Amanda, I mean, you could, either of you could probably answer this. So, you know, you receive a report from your scheme administrators at every quarterly meeting to tell you whether they've met the KPIs or not, and they'll tell you if there's been any breaches of the law. Do you need more than that?
I think for us, I mean, one thing we do look at is we look at all the AAF reports that come out on an annual basis across the board of all of our TPAs. More to understand what controls they're actually looking at, where they've got with them. It's meant to be an independent report, which it is. Looking at the areas which they've been pulled up on, you know, was it the same as last year? You know, have the ones that they had problems with or had issues with or you know, were highlighted last year, have those now been resolved and how were they resolved? So for us, it's kind of using the information we can actually get from our administrators to find out, you know, how do they control themselves? So that follows on from our own conversations and our own stewardship reports we get. It's also regular conversations. You need to be regular conversations with with your administrators as well, you know, having regular catch-ups with them. I mean, obviously in the last few years it's been difficult. You couldn't literally go in, kick the tires and see how they were working and everything else. But now things have kind of got, you know, got back to normal. That's one thing, you know, we will as trustees start to do to make sure that, you know, that the things that are saying that it's happening is actually happening. So I'm sure Rosanne's also got some great points as well.
Well, it's interesting, some of the work we've been doing recently is for a very large scheme that on the face of it, you would say is very well governed. But in just doing some of the tests around checks and balances in the reporting, one of the things that they report on are member complaints. Now, the trustee obviously has on its risk register anything to do with member data and erroneous benefit calculations. And part of the control frame for them is around the complaints that they have, the number of complaints, the type of complaints, checking if there's anything systemic in those complaints. But what was being reported in the stewardship report wasn't quite giving the full picture on what was happening behind the scenes with the administrator. And it wasn't until we lifted the lid and started to ask a few more challenging questions that we realised that a lot of the complaints that had been put through in the stewardship report over the last year or two, over 50% of them were disclosure breaches that had never been reported to the trustee, and they definitely hadn't been reported to TPR. So it wasn't until we actually lifted the lid and started asking questions that we found out that that was the case. So again, it's not a big exercise. Sometimes it's just asking the question, how do we know that what we're being told is the right thing? You know, what are the questions we have as trustees, and what are the answers we need to make sure that we can say that, you know, we're managing that data risk effectively?
Yeah. Yeah. And do you tend to go out on site visits and things like that? Or do you do annual site visits to administrators and things like that? Because quite often people do them right at the beginning of the process. I don't know whether that's an ongoing process.
I think it's definitely something. I mean, we used to do it a number of years ago. Even in my previous role, we constantly had trustees and advisors coming in to ask us questions. And you know, and I think that's real value add. I think to get to know both your administration team, the way they work, the systems they're using, and everything else. I think that's invaluable for trustees to kind of start doing that, especially around the larger schemes as well.
Well, one of the things that the regulators really focused on in the new guidance is around cybersecurity as well, isn't it? So, you know, there's been one well-known administrator in the last few weeks who's had a cybersecurity breach. And I think it was possibly in a different part of the business, actually, than pensions administration. But my experience of that has been that it was very, very difficult to get information out of the administrator concerned for several days. So I think trustees were asking all of the right questions, but were getting nothing back at all. And then TPR has contacted the schemes to say, we know that you're administered by this particular administrator. You know, what are you doing to manage the risk? So there is a very key focus on that. And I think cybersecurity is something that's going to become more of a focus going forward. What that brought home to me was, no matter what you are told up front and no matter what you think is going to happen in that situation, the reality of the situation may be different. And I suppose what that brings home to me for the purposes of, you know, looking at ESOGs and own risk assessments is again back to the point of, you've just got to keep all of this stuff under review. So I think certainly on those schemes that I advise that have got that particular administrator where they've come unstuck, I think that's brought it home to us. So I think that's something we are going to be addressing as part of this. I mean, I don't know whether you had any other thoughts around that sort of area and risk.
I'll start first and then Amanda, please chip in. Cyber is new in the code in terms of cyber controls, but the I think TPR's intention is that a cyber incident response plan is probably something that trustees should have had in place for some time, because it fits in within business continuity. And of course, business continuity has its own module in the draft code. And this is about business continuity, not just with the administrator, it's overarching ability of a trustee board to act in an event, be it cyber or something else, and be resilient to that in the aftermath. And that is quite a different way of thinking. Business continuity in cyber, I am not a cyber expert at all, but I think a lot of it is in the prevention, because when it happens, it's very difficult to do something. Once the data is gone, the horse is effectively bolted. And so it's about managing the situation thereafter. I think in some of the cyber-related data issue cases, it's about making sure that the systems that you have aren't vulnerable to penetration and attacks. And of course, most schemes will be doing exercises to ensure that's the case. What we need to manage in terms of risks and looking at the controls in place is where data is taken out of that system for any reason to do certain exercises, that it cannot be compromised, because then you are reliant on the data backups that you have in place. And if you don't have suitable backups as part of your BCP, it can fall down.
Yeah. Thank you. We've had a question in which this may be one for you to kick off, Amanda. So the question is around how trustees set their long-term administration objectives and what those should include. So we've got things like disclosure breaches that we've mentioned, but I wondered if there was anything else.
Oh gosh. I want to think about that one now. Rosanne, you got any clue? For us, we work in relationship with our administrators. You've got to, and I think, I think it's reminding ourselves of what the role is, reminding ourselves of what those services they provide for us is. You know, one thing we're doing as part of sort of an ongoing review of all of our things out of the back of cyber and everything else is looking at the terms and conditions we've got, looking at those SLAs, having frank conversations. You know, if there are issues, we want them to be able to come up to the trustees and tell us that there's been some disclosure breaches, and not for us to have to go and dig around and ask, awkward questions. So I think the objectives for us is probably, to work with our administrators very closely to make sure that they're also aligned with what we want as trustees. You know, it's no good as us having conversations around end games and things like that, and we're working in silos. So I think for me as an objective to work with my administrators closely to make sure they're aligned with what we're doing and that they're aware of all of our plans, and make sure that we keep a close eye on what they're doing and how they're doing it, and not be afraid to ask those questions, but also be open for them to come to talk to us as well if and when there are any issues.
And Amanda, that's got to be the right approach, hasn't it? Because one of the things that's happening across the industry at the moment is just capacity crunches with advisors and providers. And I think it's particularly acute at the admin end of things. It's just not possible for administrators to do all of the projects that people want to do sometimes, is it? So actually being clear and upfront and honest and having that conversation about what is possible, and then prioritising what needs to be done from an admin point of view, I think is absolutely key, isn't it, at the moment in particular?
Very much. I mean, we're all aware of the resource constraints across the board, to be perfectly honest, but very much on that admin front. And I think it is having those conversations, and it's, trustees aren't ogres. We're quite happy to kind of sit down and, whilst we might have SLAs within our, within our terms and conditions and with our contracts, we can look at them. If there are areas where we need to sort of be a bit more lenient on, then have those conversations and be up and, upfront and honest. And, if we are looking to do sort of lots of projects, make sure we phase them correctly, make sure that the resource is there and that they're fully aware of what we're doing, and sort of have that agreement. But we are fully aware of the resource constraints across the board, within the administration. So I think it is just having that real close contact with your administrators.
Yeah, because otherwise you you've got other risks coming in, haven't you? If people are trying to rush through stuff, that creates risks in itself, I think.
Yeah.
So, thank you. I had a question for both of you, and maybe there's some self-interest in this. What, in your experience, how far along the track are most trustees with all of this? Because I think there's been so much going on, and people have got so many different focuses at the moment. And because we haven't got the final version of the code at the moment, I think some people have sort of pushed this to the back burner a little bit. But I'll be really interested in hearing your views on that.
I think there's a lot of sitting on the fence, and probably rightly so. You know, until it's final, how do you know for sure what actually needs to be done? You don't want to spend time and precious money on doing something that you might have to unpick. So I absolutely understand why that's the case. Where some schemes have started to make progress, it's typically because they've wanted to do a risk management exercise already, or they're thinking about how do we plan our journey to buyout. And this has been a helpful way to help them think about it. So those schemes where we are further along the line of the work to comply with the code and also undertake the onerous assessment has been stimulated by something else. I think those trustees who see the value in doing this because it's good governance have made progress, but I think the vast majority are waiting to see what happens next.
That gives me some relief.
I was going to say, from my point of view, probably most of the schemes that we have under Ross Trustees have gone for the ESOG, and have at least, as a minimum, got that gap analysis, and are slowly working through those priority orders of what needs to be done. So, but with regards to the ORA, I think we are kind of very much just waiting to see what that final version is.
Thank you. So I've probably got time for one more question before I go to sort of sum up and close. How strict do you think TPR's going to be with all of this? You know, it's been delayed. There's been, you know, it freely admits that there's a lot of work for trustees to do for the kind of start of the process. Do you think it's going to be scrutinising schemes, scrutinising what they've done on this? Do you think it's going to be strict and you know, be looking at what people have done and criticising how they've approached this?
That's not the sense I've got from the webinars which I've attended, where Nick Gannon, who's the lead on the code, has been talking about TPR's expectations. They appreciate, I think, that there's a lot of work to be done, and I think he feels he probably shouldn't have mentioned the word significant in the code in the original draft, because it's probably created more worry than has been helpful. But I think the intention, as he was saying around the onerous assessment, is that it needs to be at a level that is going to be helpful and relevant to the schemes when they do it. It's not an exercise in a huge amount of box ticking for the sake of making sure you've gone through the code and have every single thing in place. Yes, of course, you need to be compliant. But again, it's being proportionate to what that compliance looks like. If you know, the remuneration policy is we're still looking at what that might be. And I think, having seen some of the slides Nick put out, it's more than trustee remuneration. It's the remuneration of the providers. Basically, it's the remuneration of anybody who provides a service to the scheme, whether that all has to go in the trustee remuneration policy or whether you can have an advisor provider policy that captures some of those points. It's about, you know, how much do you need to put in there? If it's just one line and that does the job for you, then it's one line. Some schemes might have 7-page policy because they need to go into that level of detail. So I think, again, TPR is going to be very mindful that it's not all going to look the same.
Yeah.
It's not comparing apples with apples. It's going to be apples with pears for some time. And I think maybe what they will look to do in the future, as they've done with some of the other code, particularly around master trust, is look at what is good in the market and then perhaps guide schemes towards that, because they've looked at it and they've seen what they think is most helpful or representative of what they're trying to achieve through the code.
Yeah, that makes sense. Right. I'm going to ask Rosie just to put up our final slide, if I may, Rosie. Thank you very much. So these are really just, I suppose, my key takeaways from the discussion that we've had today. So my first key takeaway is you need to have a plan, you need to allocate responsibility for who's going to carry out the plan, and you need to prioritise what it is that you actually want to achieve through the exercise. Next, you need to carry out your gap analysis and just identify what might be missing. And then you need to put in place a process for filling in those gaps, but in a proportionate way. And then finally, for trustees, I think it's a really good idea to add all of this to the trustee business plan, whether that's things that need to be done to fill in the gaps or whether that's the review of everything in 12 months time after you've done it, just to make sure that nothing is missed and you remain compliant. So for me, I think those are the three key takeaways from today's discussion. So it just remains with me to say thank you ever so much to all of our speakers, Rosanne and Amanda and Maddy. And I hope you've all found this a useful session. If you have any follow-up questions, please drop myself or Maddy, Rosanne or Amanda a line, and we'd be happy to pick those up after the session. Thanks ever so much.